Hi, today I'm going to show you how to use the most important tool in your culinary toolkit, the chef's knife. Okay, so this is your chef's knife, and it is, like I said, the most important tool in your culinary toolkit. If you don't have other tools, it's totally okay because your chef's knife can do a lot of the things that other appliances would otherwise help you do. It can replace a mandolin, a Cuisinart, and lots of other things. You can do a lot with your knife if you know how to use it. And so what I'm gonna do for you today is show you some basic knife skills so you get more comfortable if you practice these skills and you can master your knife. And this is about like an 8 or 9 inch chef's knife. This is the sharp side, this is the dull side. First, let's talk about how to hold your knife. This knife has a bottom part here that kind of acts as a guard. So the way we're gonna hold it is we're gonna take our hand, our dominant hand, and make like a shadow puppet of a little dog here, woof woof. And we're gonna wrap our fingers around the bottom. Now the important thing is you want your fingers touching this bottom guard part of the knife. I see a lot of people do this or this or this. You want your fingers parallel to the floor and you want them butted up against the bottom here. And I want you guys to point your fingers this way and this thumb goes up, and you'll see why in a minute. Then we're gonna swivel the knife around and you're gonna put your thumb on one side, your index finger on the other, kind of like you're holding a pencil. So this should be somewhat familiar to you. And if you're not used to this, it can feel a little bit awkward, and that is okay. Sometimes learning something new is a little bit awkward, and that's okay. But I promise you, if you get comfortable with this, you'll see that it helps out a lot. It makes things more efficient, easier, and you'll have way more control over your knife. You've probably heard choking up. And what that means is we're just bringing our hands closer to the action so that we have better control. And that's because this is the part of the knife that we're gonna use to cut. So we wanna bring our hands closer to it so we have more control over the knife. Another little thing I like to show people is the difference between maybe how they used to hold it and how choking up feels. Go ahead and grab the knife at the bottom and move it around in your hand a little bit, and you'll see, I'm pretty sure you'll see, that you have way less control over the knife. So remember to bring your hand up and choke up on your blade. All right, so now we know how to hold our knife, but what do we do with our other hand? Our other hand is the one that tends to get cut. So what I'm gonna have you guys do is make a claw. So what you're doing is you're basically bringing all your fingertips back and in towards the center of your palm. And I'm gonna show you with an actual vegetable how this works. So you're gonna use your claw to hold your onion or whatever you're cutting. And what this does is it creates a safe place for your knuckles to rest and keeps your fingertips curled away from the sharp blade of the knife. So you can see we can hold our onion here and then slice down on it. And that keeps our fingertips nice and safe. Also, the claw can be used for chopping smaller things. Just because something gets small doesn't mean you give up your technique. It just means we adjust and accommodate. So instead of having your fingers like this, you can bring and make what I call a baby claw. So now you have your middle finger and then your other finger stacked up behind it with your thumb. And then you kind of bring your fingertips up like this. And you can see that we still are keeping our fingertips nice and safe. They're away from the blade, but they're still able to hold and stabilize whatever it is we're chopping. Something that I see a lot of people do, and everybody cringes when I show them this, but they still will do it, is you don't wanna do this. Does this look safe to anybody? You don't wanna be feeding your fingertips into the sharp blade of the knife. Especially ladies with long fingernails, you definitely wanna bring your fingers back. You don't want fingernail in the food. Your manicure is lovely, but it doesn't taste that great. Okay, so now you know what to do with the knife hand, you know what to do with the stabilizing hand, don't get it cut, make the claw. So now I wanna talk a little bit about cutting techniques. If I place the blade on my hand like this, it doesn't cut me, and I'm pressing pretty hard. But if I were to slide the blade down my hand, it would cut me really bad and really deep. So we wanna use that to our advantage when we're cutting things. We want to use a sliding and rocking motion with our knife. So you want to start with the tip of your blade on your cutting board like this, and then you're going to follow the natural curvature of your blade and slide forward and down. And then you're going to come back the way you came and rock back up. So it's like a rocking and rolling motion, and you should feel the knife making little cuts into your cutting board. That is how you know that you're getting it done. And this will save you a lot of time and energy because you'll be able to cut through things much easier. I see a lot of people just like muscling through and trying to push the knife through, but if you slide the blade, it makes the job much easier. The best example of a place where you want to use the rocking and chopping is with tomatoes. Tomatoes have a pretty tough skin, but a very soft, juicy inside. And we don't want to make salsa on our cutting board all the time. Sometimes we want the tomato to stay in nice little cube shapes. So the rocking and sliding comes in so handy here. You want to slide your blade across the tomato and down. And can you see how I got a perfect nice cut and there's not tomato juice running all over the cutting board? And I can continue to do that, sliding and rocking, sliding and rocking. And now we have these nice, clean chunks of tomato. And this is a relatively ripe tomato. The riper the tomato, the softer, the juicier, the more important it is to slide your blade all the way down that piece of fruit and do not try to muscle it. And then the other technique I want to talk about is mincing. So you're going to rest your hand on the top of the blade and think of it as the arm of a clock, where this is the center of the clock and these are the numbers out here. You want your knife to go around in a fan shape while you mince. And this hand is up here to stabilize the top of the blade so that you don't end up doing some other wild shape on your cutting board. We want to kind of have it in a nice fan shape. And I'll show you with some actual herbs to show you what that looks like. And we're gonna chop and mince. And can you see how there we are? It's already almost chopped and I'm going out. And you can bring it back in the center and then go back over it and keep going until you get it nice and fine. And you can see it only took a couple passes and we got our mint pretty fine, just like that. Now that we know how to hold our knife and we know what to do with this hand to keep it safe and to have it stabilize our veggies, let's try with an actual piece of vegetable. So the main thing you want to keep in mind is you want to keep things on a flat and stable surface. The less rocking and rolling, the better. Nature doesn't really help us because a lot of fruits and veggies come in round shapes, shape like this, whatever this cauliflower shape is. It doesn't always come in nice, neat little boxes. So one of the important things is to try to find the most stable side to make our first cut. So I'm just gonna put my potato here. This feels like the most stable, and I'm gonna make my first cut. So now I have these two halves, and I have one round side and one flat side. Always make the next cut when the vegetable is on the flat side. This is way easier to cut now than this. This is rocking and rolling and it's going to be tricky. So always just put it down like this and then make the next cut. And every time you cut, try to find the most stable place to make the next cut from. So now we're going to make a couple more cuts because I want these to be in cubes. And we're just going to go down a couple more times. And if this looks tricky to you, honestly, the biggest part of knife skills is practice. If you ever saw that movie Julie and Julia where she goes ham on all those onions in her kitchen, that is how it is done. You just gotta keep going and keep practicing. It takes a lot of practice, a lot of mistakes to get really good and fast and to make the clean cuts you wanna make. So don't be discouraged, just keep going. So I'm gonna make one more cut into these guys, and you can see that now I took that round potato and I have some nice cubes in here. So these are great for like putting in a soup or something like that. And you can make them as big or small as you want. Okay, so the next cut I'm gonna talk about is a julienne. Julienne is basically like a long, fine cut, kind of like matchsticks sometimes it'll be described as in your cookbooks. So once again, let's find a stable place for our carrot. This is a lovely purple and yellow carrot. And I'm gonna cut it in half because I want it to be on a stable flat surface for my next cuts. The next thing I get to decide is how long do I want my julienne, right? These are like a matchstick cut. They can be longer. You can make long julienne or short julienne. I think I want to make mine about the half the length of the carrot that I have now. So I'm gonna cut these guys in half. There we go. And I'm gonna start with this one piece here. Now the idea is that these are very small, fine cuts, and then we're gonna go back and cut it again. So with our knife, we're gonna take it and cut nice, fine cuts this way. So they're just basically really thin, fine slices. And I'm going slow so you guys can see it. There you go. Another thing about knife skills is that a lot of people try to go super fast and, you know, aren't very patient with themselves. It's totally okay to go slow. Go slow, get the hang of it, get comfortable. You'll pick up speed when you pick up comfortability. That's normal, right? But don't try to go nuts and go fast because your cuts will be imprecise, they'll be a mess, and you will also run the risk of cutting yourself. Then we're gonna go back and cut again, like this, and we're gonna use our baby claw and try to line these little carrots up here and cut it like that. And then I'm gonna cut these guys maybe one more time. Once, one more here. And you can see they come out in these nice long matchstick shapes, right? So this is great for salads. Sometimes graters kind of make a mess of the fruit or the vegetable. So sometimes a julienne is really nice for a salad or a slaw or as a beautiful garnish. Or if you're making a wrap and you wanna fill your wrap with something like this or for sushi rolls. So a julienne is a really important cut to know how to do because it allows you to do really beautiful things like this. Okay, so the next technique we're gonna do is called chiffonade. And I love this with herbs because A, it makes a beautiful presentation, and B, it's just a nice way to be able to cut some herbs without mincing them up if you want them to be a little bit different. Chiffonade is great for basil, mint, sorrel, other leafy greens that you wanna turn into long, pretty thin ribbons. So you start off by taking the leaves off of your herb. And I like to stack them flat on my cutting board. So you see I have three mint leaves layered here. And then you're just gonna roll them up, you know, like a yoga mat or a funny cigarette or whatever you wanna call it. And then you're gonna go and make thin slices this way. So this is, you know, can you see that there's a pattern to the cutting? It's like basically the same thing over and over again. But if you can rock, and if you can master the rock and chop, you can also master chiffonade and julienne and chopping things into beautiful little cubes. It's just that easy. I'm basically doing the same thing over and over again, but I'm getting different results in different shapes depending on how I do it. The other technique I really want to show you guys is how to chop an onion. It's not much different from the other things, except for onions burn my eyes. I don't know if they burn yours, but they burn the hell out of mine. So I wear goggles at home sometimes if I'm chopping a large quantity of onions, but if I'm just doing one, the best way to keep the onion from burning my eyes is to just make the fewest cuts possible. Well, you start off by chopping the onion through the root. So this is the root here, and this is the top part. Like if I planted this in dirt, the flower would come out here, the plant would come out here, and these roots would grow down, right? So you wanna cut the onion this ways, through here. I say this all the time in class and people still turn it and cut it in half this ways. Just think about it as the plant and imagine cutting the plant in half, right? So you wanna cut through the root, through the root, through the root. So I'm gonna turn the root towards you just to emphasize the point. And we're gonna cut it in half through the root. I'm gonna put it on its cut side immediately to keep it from being exposed to air because that is the burny part. Then I'm gonna take the first layer. You know, sometimes there's a gross layer of the outside of the onion and I'm just gonna pull that off. And it's okay because I'm gonna use this later for my veggie stock. Then I'm going to cut off this top part. Once again, this is not the root, this is the part where the plant would grow from. So I'm gonna cut that part off just a little bit just to get that little brown bit off. So then the next thing we're gonna do is similar to the way we chopped the potato, you wanna think about what size of a chop do you want, right? So I'm gonna just make my first cut into the onion, and I'm stopping short about a half an inch or so from the bottom of the root. So the root stays intact. We're not cutting the root off. And then I want it to be pretty fine, so I'm gonna make a really small, narrow next cut. And then I'm gonna make another narrow next cut. And as I move down, I'm gonna kind of go in an arc because I wanna keep the back of the onion intact. So try not to cut through all the way through the onion. You just kind of wanna go down, make another cut, and maybe come all the way down. And you can see that these are pretty narrow and thin cuts because I want it to be a pretty fine chop. So now that I've gotten my cuts, and maybe you can see that those are pretty fine, those are pretty thin slices. Now I'm gonna kind of try to do the same level of slice, but I'm gonna go parallel to the floor and I'm gonna cut through the onion. So I'm gonna go, and the trick is to try to keep your knife relatively parallel so you're not making, you know, strange angled cuts. And try not to cut your fingers. Always try not to cut your fingers. So now we've got all our cuts in our onion, and now it's time to make the magic happen. So we're just gonna slice down, and as you can see, our onion is very minced, and this is the first time it's being exposed to air, so my poor eyeballs are being saved. Thank you. And you can see, once you get to the back and it's a little bit, then we can use our mincing technique and get the rest of the onion chopped up. But the bulk of the work has been done for us. We've barely exposed it to air. My eyes are not burning yet. So that's great. So we've chopped half an onion with just a few cuts. Now you know how to hold your knife. You know what to do with this hand to keep it safe. You know to keep your vegetables on the flat side so that they're nice and stable. And we've learned some really cool new cutting techniques like cutting into cubes, chiffonade, julienne, mincing. All of these will serve you really well in your culinary adventures in the kitchen. So get in there, get practicing, and I'll see you next time.